subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Now, last week, the West Bengal government formed a two-member inquiry commission, and this was basically to look into reports of allegations of snooping on politicians, officials, and journalists using the Pegasus spyware developed by the Israeli cyber intelligence company, the NSO Group. The commission has two members, former Supreme Court Judge Justice M.B. Lokur and former Calcutta High Court Judge Justice Jyotirmay Bhattacharya, and they'll basically look into these this alleged surveillance of phones that's being reported over the past few days. So in today's KYC episode, I'll explain to you how such an inquiry commission can be set up and what it can do. So basically, this commission, like any other inquiry commission, has been set up under the Commissions of Inquiry Act 1952. Now, both the central as well as the state governments can set up such an inquiry commission under this law. But as per Section 2A of this Act, the central government can appoint a commission on any matters related to the entries in any of the three lists in the 7th schedule. But a state government can do so only on the entries in the second and the third list. Now we know that as far as the power to make laws is concerned, the 7th schedule of the constitution deals with the division between the center and the states. The 7th schedule has three lists for this purpose: the union list, the state list, and the concurrent list. And basically through these three lists, it lays down the subjects on which the center can make laws and the subjects on which the states can make laws. Now, as per Article 246, the Parliament has exclusive powers to make laws on the subjects in the Union List, while the state legislature can exclusively make laws on the subjects in the state list. As for the third list, which is the concurrent list, both centre and state governments can enact laws listed under it, but if there's a conflict between the laws, the central law will override the state law. And keeping this in mind is why the West Bengal notification setting up this commission specifically talks about the entries in the state list and the concurrent list, which it says will be impacted if the reported interception is actually found to be true. It says that if that is found to be true, it will have widespread ramifications on public order and police. And then it points out that these are stateless subjects. Entry 1 of stateless talks about public order, while entry 2 talks about police. The notification also cites a few other entries for justification for appointment of the commission. It says that the reported interception, again, if it is at all found to be true, will also have ramifications. It will impact the local government, which is under entry 5 of the state list. Entry 5 talks about local government, including municipal corporations. It includes district boards and similar other local authorities. And the notification mentions entry 39 of the state list as well, which talks about powers, privileges, and immunities of the legislative assemblies, its members, and its committees. And apart from these state list subjects, it mentions criminal law as well, which is a part of the concurrent list. So basically, it mentions these subjects to justify the appointment of the commission. Also, who appoints such an inquiry commission first is also important, because as I mentioned, both the state governments as well as the central government can make such an appointment. So Section 3 of the Commissions of Inquiry Act 1952 makes this clear. It says that if in a matter the central government has already appointed a commission, then no state government can appoint another commission to inquire into the same matter till the central government commission is still functioning. This can only be done. The state government can only appoint a commission on the same subject with center's prior permission. So these are the two conditions: that the center's commission, the commission appointed by the central government, should have finished functioning, or that the center should have given special permission for the state government to form a commission to look into the same subject matter. But in a scenario opposite to this, if a commission has already been set up by the state government first, any state government, the central government can still set up another commission if it feels that the scope of the inquiry needs to be extended to two or more states. So it will have to justify the formation of such a commission on this ground. And that is why this notification by the West Bengal government also mentions that the central government has not appointed any commission of inquiry to look into the matter so far. So it is making this appointment right now. In the past, of course, there have been instances when different commissions of inquiry have been set up for the same purpose, say by the central government and the state government. For example, the Godhra train burning and subsequent riots saw two inquiry commissions being set up. One was in 2002 by the Gujarat government when Narendra Modi was the Gujarat chief minister, and another in 2004 by Lalu Prasad Yadav, who was then the Union Railways minister in the Congress-led UPA government. Now, while the commission set up by the state government gave a clean chit to the state government, the other commission that I mentioned that was appointed by Lalu Prasad Yadav reported contrary findings. But at the end of this, the Gujarat High Court ruled that the commission set up by Lalu Prasad Yadav was illegal because at the time that it was constituted, the state appointed commission was still functional and was already looking into the subject matter. So this commission's findings were therefore quashed. Similarly, when the Delhi government and the central government sparred over who had the power to appoint commissions of inquiry when it came to Delhi, the Supreme Court had to intervene and rule that in case of Delhi, it would be the central government that could appoint such a commission. Now let's get back to the West Bengal notification for a bit. As per the notification, which was issued on 26 July, the commission has 12 terms of references. It basically needs to inquire into whether any incidents of interception actually occurred, look into the government and the non-government people involved, the spyware that was used, details of those who were affected by it, legality of the entire thing or the reasons given by the interceptors, and also to look into whether the right to privacy of those people whose calls were intercepted was actually affected. And to look into these things, a commission of inquiry basically under the 1952 Act basically has the same powers that a civil court does. So what this means is that the commission can summon and force someone to appear before them and examine such a person on oath. It can direct someone to produce any sort of document before it. It can take evidence on affidavits. It can ask for public records or copies of it from any court or office. Additionally, the commission can also ask any person to provide any information on a matter that it might think is, say, relevant or useful. And when it does this, the person who it has asked to produce such information would be legally bound to give such an information to the commission. Now, this commission set up by the West Bengal government would also have these powers, and it has to submit its report with recommendations to the state government within 6 months. The reports by these commissions are usually and normally tabled in the state assembly if the commission was constituted by the state government, and in the parliament if the commission was constituted by the central government. As per the law, this needs to be done within 6 months of the submission of the commission report. This is Apoorva Mandhani for The Print. For more such videos, do subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on Twitter, Instagram and Facebook.